All right. Voiceover Body Shop is coming up next. We've got Johnny Heller with us.
Yes.
We're going to talk about characters and voiceover or audiobooks and things along those lines. Should be a lot of fun. Answer your questions from the chat room. Just go to VOBS.TV if you're watching there now. Go in the chat room. It's real easy, and we'll get it on. And so we're having a lot of fun tonight. It's Monday night. It's time for VOBS next.
Two men, twin sons from different mothers, with a passion for voiceover recording technology and the desire to make recording easy for voice actors everywhere, together in one place. George Whittam, the home studio engineer to the stars, a Virginia Tech grad with an unmatched knowledge of all the latest gear and technology in voiceover today. Dan Leonard, the home studio master, a voice actor with over 30 years experience in broadcasting and recording, and a no-holds-barred, myth-busting attitude for teaching you how easy it is. Together, finally, to bring you all the latest technology, the superstars of voiceover today, and leading the discussion on how to make the most of your voiceover business. This is Voiceover Body Shop. And now, live from their super-secret multimedia studio in Sherman Oaks, California, here are George Whittam and Dan Leonard.
Hi, I'm Dan Leonard.
And I'm George Whittam.
And this is VoiceOver
Body Shop.
Or VO...
BS.
There you go.
Yeah, you like
to make me wait. I love being the director, of course. How's everybody doing tonight? It's Monday night. It's time for VoiceOver Body Shop. First, we have to thank our sponsors, because without them, this wouldn't happen. You know, we've got Harlan Hogan.
VoiceOver Extra.
Edge Studio.
Source Elements.
VO2GoGo.com.
And Antland Productions.
Uncle Roy, thanks a lot. All right. Tonight, our guest is Johnny Heller.
Mm-hmm.
He's going to be joining us in a few minutes, talking about audiobooks and doing characters and nonfiction. We're going to talk about a bunch of different things. Should be very, very different. If you have a technical question for us, because this is VoiceOver Body Shop, and it is about voiceover home technology.
That's right.
Or home voiceover studio technology.
Mm-hmm.
Or VO studio tech is...
Or personal studio technology.
Personal studio tech. Yeah, any one of those things. Put it in the chat room. And Anthony or Shelley, who is ever monitoring the chat room tonight, will get that question to us, and we will answer it live on this very show.
And another experiment we're trying tonight, because we love trying new stuff, is we are streaming on Facebook Live for the very first time. So some of you might be watching this on Facebook. If you're just on Facebook, you're welcome to put your questions in the chat below the feed, and Shelley will be checking that as well. So we'll put your questions anywhere you put them.
It's a new dawn. I remember when stereo TV first happened, and that was like really cool. Now we're live on Facebook. It's reality. All right. But anyway, now,
the VoiceOver Extra, VOBS News, the latest and most comprehensive voiceover industry news. Brought to you live.
All righty. It's May 16th, the VoiceOver Extra News. What audiobook producers want. With whoops and applause, the audiobook industry celebrated and honored the best in spoken word entertainment in the United States, at least, at the Audi Awards Gala last week in Chicago. Congratulations to the winning narrators in this annual competition sponsored by the Audio Publishers Association. And you can still see them all, including the finalists, in all 25 award categories on VoiceOver Extra now. Of course, this leads narrators to ponder how they, too, can get to the top ranks of this biz. And the first step is getting the right audiobook publishers to notice you. So how do you do that? Well, last week, on the day preceding the Audi Awards Gala, the APA sponsored its annual APAC conference, where narrators enjoyed educational sessions and got to mingle with all the publishers. Now, if you weren't there, you'll want to know what narrator Tom Deere dug up in interviews for a feature just posted on VoiceOver Extra. Now, during and prior to APAC, Tom talked with audiobook publishers on a range of issues. Here's a sampling. What qualities do you look for in a narrator when casting an audiobook? from Deborah Dion from Dion Audio. I'm looking for the best narrator to speak as the voice of the author. Authenticity. I hear the most subtle things, and a wrong accent and a wrong pronunciation pulls me right out of the story. From Alan Castor from Invinifox. The quality I look for most when casting a narrator is vocal flexibility. By this I mean they can read in multiple voices. Can they read with a foreign accent when necessary? And can they read technical and scientific jargon? And for Miles Millman, Books in Motion, he says, I'm firstly looking for a storyteller, someone who knows how to deliver the narrative portions of the book with an instinct for understanding the author's intent in a given sentence or paragraph. Now another question, what qualities do you look for in a narrator? Oh, it stopped right in the middle on me.
That's fun.
I hate when it does that, but I can pick it up. Go to the backup script. Mm-hmm. It says, from Aaron Blank from Random House, mm-hmm. their ability to make whatever is on my mind disappear and have the story they're telling take over. It's all storytelling. And from Arnie Cardillo from Live Oak Media, a narrator who leaves his or her ego at the door. Someone who's willing to cooperate with the director and everyone involved in the production and who will do what is necessary to produce a quality recording. Now, to be sure, to rise to the top in this business truly takes skill and hard work. And you can learn more about it in Tom's interviews now on voiceoverextra.com, your daily resource for voiceover success.
The audiobook community is just as warm and interconnected, at least in my experience, as the voiceover community.
Sure, of course, there's a lot of them.
There's a lot of overlap, too.
Yes, but absolutely.
Just as interesting as there's overlap, there's a lot of that there isn't. There's a lot of people that are strictly audiobook narrators, and they have really no interest in crossing over into other genres of voiceover.
That's true.
That's their world.
Yeah, and I'll bet you Johnny will want to talk about that tonight, too.
Yeah, definitely.
It's a big business, and a lot of people getting into it. And that's all they do. You know, it's like, you know, we talk about voiceover. Audiobooks is sort of like this part of voiceover.
It is. It's like that Venn diagram, you know, with the circles that overlap in the middle, and in the middle is voiceover.
Right.
They're these interesting worlds that have some commonalities, you know. I got to meet Deborah Dion and see her facility at a party they hosted on Cinco de Mayo mm-hmm. for Bob's anniversary mm-hmm. of his birthday. I think that was what it was. And wham, what an amazing facility. Really, really yeah. nice place. And there's five rooms that are open in there from 8 a.m. to I think she runs it from 8 a.m. to 10 p.m. Wow. 7 days a week. Isn't wow. that amazing?
like I always say, they want everything since Gutenberg recorded. So
it's quite a beautiful place.
I'll have to get over there because it's not too far from here. It's like
it's up the highway. Up the
101,
405. Actually,
up the 405.
Up the 405.
You see, that's the thing I've learned about California. All highways start with the.
Because anyway, it's the Pacific Coast Highway, the, you know,
the so 405, the 101, the 110.
Because the highways predated numbers here, and so everything had a the in front of it.
Yeah, but every time I get on the 101 and it says Ventura Highway, I go, Ventura Highway, in the sunshine.
Yeah, of course,
it's being part of California. Okay, too much chit-chat. We've got Johnny Heller coming up in a bit, and your tech questions if you got them, so stay tuned. We'll be right back, but first, you've got to tell us about Source Connect.
Oh, that's right. Source Connect.
Right.
Well, you know what? Last week I had a little video package about Source Connect. A lot of you guys didn't see it. And rather than basically rehash what is being said better by Robert from Source Elements himself, let me just run that again because a lot of you may not have seen it. So here's a little interview with Robert from NAB about the new stuff from Source Elements.
Hey everybody, it's George Woodham reporting for Woodham's World at NAB 2016 here in Las Vegas. And I've run into my buddy Robert Marshall here at Source Elements, the makers of Source Connect. What is going on? What's exciting at Source Connect? What do people have to look forward to?
We are going to release Source Connect 3.9 very soon. So there's a couple new features in there, mainly to do with ports and availability, even if you can't get ports open, and also addressing reliability of your internet connection. So if you don't have a reliable internet connection, we can make sure that you have a strong internet connection even in any condition.
What is exciting about this port thing? For people that are the uninitiated, maybe they've never used Source Connect, why are ports an issue and what are you guys doing to address that?
So ports, when you have your port open, it allows you to receive audio from whoever you're connected with. Source Connect has traditionally relied on having open ports. It can then break through a firewall if you can't get your ports open. But eventually, it's possible that if you can't manage your firewall is too strong, that Source Connect traditionally used to not be able to receive in certain situations. So the first new option we have is called Source Stream. And essentially, if it gets down to that point where your ports are not open, Source Connect will then bounce all the data off of our servers, and it will guarantee you a receive signal, no matter what your situation is with firewalls. You know, you're at a hotel.
You're at your friend's house while you're on vacation.
Who knows? Exactly. So that's the first option we have, is it guarantees you the ability to receive. But the other condition that you end up in sometimes if you're on the road is you're at a hotel, and maybe the Wi-Fi at the hotel is not great Wi-Fi. So we're going to have SourceNet as well, which is a service you can sign up for that will allow you to use two simultaneous internet connections at the same time. So it's bonding them together, not for extra speed, but for redundancy. So
you can have the hotel Wi-Fi turned on, and then you can turn on the hotspot mode on your iPhone or whatever.
Exactly. And so the chances of both those networks having a dropout on the same packet at the same time are extremely low. It improves your internet reliability by more than 50%.
That's huge.
Statistically.
That's huge, in the fact that you're building into the product, so the learning curve or from the user end, it's going to be easy to use.
And it's exactly right. And it's also it's extremely usable because you can have the bonding service, but the other person doesn't have to have it necessarily. Ideally, you both have it and you have a bonded connection from one end to the other. But we take your bonded connection and put it out to the public internet through our data center. So if you only have the bonding, at least you're getting up to the internet with an extremely strong connection.
It's far less of a problem. What am I saying? Then as the voice actor who's out in the field, you can say, look, man, I've got redundancy. So those dropouts dropouts aren't my problem.
That's
They're
right.
your problem.
Tell your clients to get off of Netflix or whatever.
Exactly.
Exactly.
Well, that's
right.
Great, man. 3.9, when is it going to release?
We are hoping 3.9 will be released definitely within the next couple months, if not sooner.
So
it's
like early
very late beta right now.
Early summer.
Exactly.
Something like
yep.
that. Okay, great.
So that, and then, yep.
Thanks a lot, Robert. Good to see you again.
Thank you.
As always, a pleasure.
Thank you.
Widom's World.
Are you confused about how to set up and maintain a professional quality voiceover studio? No wonder. The information out there is mostly mythology. This is the best microphone to use. You have to have a preamp. You need a soundproof booth. This software is the best. Your audio must be broadcast quality. Consult with someone who knows the truth. Someone who's been there, in the trenches, doing voiceover for over 30 years. Someone with unparalleled experience with voiceover studios. Who's worked with hundreds of voice actors and designed hundreds of personal studios. He knows how to teach and cares about your success. In one of the harshest environments known to voiceover, your home. Dan Leonard, the Home Studio Master. Separate myth from fact and get a handle on your personal voiceover studio. Contact the Home Studio Master at homevoiceoverstudio.com. Drop off a specimen of your dry audio for a free analysis.
Learn the latest in voiceover technology, business, and good old-fashioned acting.
I really like your bracelet. It's awesome.
Hey, Paul, where did you get that watch?
That's really cool.
And a hamburger with no cheese, please.
Every Monday, 9 Eastern, 6 Pacific, only on voiceoverbodyshop.com.
All right, we're back on VoiceOver Body Shop, thanking our sponsors again because it's important that we get this done. And, you know, you can donate to the show, too.
Yes, you can.
Right above us here. If you look above us, at least on our page. Now, on the Facebook page, that's totally different.
Yeah, we got to figure that out yet.
See, now what we're discovering is that people are watching on both pages. We can't get people to send us a question for whatever. But we say, oh, by the way, we're on Facebook. And now everybody's saying, oh, wait a second, Facebook is ahead of the regular channel. Like, they're watching both. They can't get enough
of this. Facebook is ahead by about 20 seconds at least.
Yeah, it's only about a 7-second delay.
Yeah.
But stay in the chat room, you know, whatever works best for you.
Yeah, have fun.
Yes. But anyway, talking about what works best for you, and we were talking about audiobooks earlier, We've got a great guest tonight who's going to talk to us about audiobooks and all sorts of cool stuff. And that is Johnny Heller joining us from New York City. Johnny, how are you?
Hello, my friends. Thanks for having me on.
Great to have you on here. It's great to see you again. Now,
wow, there is a delay. I can see that. It's weird.
don't watch this bunch. Don't watch the feed.
Yeah, you'll be 7 seconds behind. Anyway,
like a bad Japanese monster movie.
Right.
Exactly. Anyway, tell us a little bit about yourself, Johnny, because I'm sure people are familiar with you, but tell us how you got into audiobooks and voiceover in general and stuff.
Okay, I'm from Chicago originally, and I was studying classical theater, Shakespeare, at the Tedlitz Studio for Performing Arts after I was a newspaper reporter for the Chicago Sun-Times. And then I went into theater stuff, and I did stand-up comedy for a number of years. And then I started, my voiceover teacher was a commercial guy. And in those days, all the commercials were done by the voice of God, you know, those really deep, rich voices that I don't possess. And he brought some agents in to watch us do some scene work. And I sound like this. So they called me in because I have a quirky voice. And I started working immediately in commercial voiceover. I literally got my first job that I auditioned for, a big national spot. I always tell people about it, for Campbell's Soup. And the Campbell's Soup people have gone everywhere to find the right guy. And what I had to say was this. Mm-mm. That was it. I got it. I realized then what a crazy-ass business this is. I paid like 15 grand for that. I'm thinking, who failed at that spot? But apparently somebody did, and I got the job. So from then on, it was... many, many years of working in restaurants and bars to become the overnight success I now am.
Well, and I'm sure working in bars did a lot to help you with storytelling and stuff.
You betcha.
So you were at APAC last week.
Yes.
And
Tell everybody what APAC is.
Oh, that's the, we just talked about it with Tom Deere's article.
The American Audio Public Producers Association Convention.
Right. You know, it, like NAB, only not quite as big, but important because audiobooks are so important.
It's the NAB of the audiobook world, right?
It is, yes. Mm-hmm. To all the producers go. The BEA, the Book Expo America, is generally those are things in New York, and the APA, the Publishers Association, pretty much has to follow where the BEA goes, mm-hmm. because that's where they do all their deals. So that's where APAC was in Chicago this year, which is my hometown. And it was a wonderful experience. Tavia Gilbert, Caitlin Gehring of Harper, and I helped do the scheduling for some of the APAC stuff. It was a wonderful experience. Everybody has a great time. It's a real good time to schmooze. Publishers, producers are there, and if you want to meet them, they're there to be met. And the parties are fabulous. And I put on a few parties and a workshop the day before that we had a huge turnout for. I had 10 fabulous coaches. Had about 120 narrators in a place, and we worked from 9 to about 4:30 on different areas of the business.
Now, that must be interesting, being in a conference with a bunch of audiobook narrators, because is it everybody like, you ask somebody a question and they go on for a chapter or two? Or?
Yeah, it's a solitary business, but these people are just desperate for someone to chat with. Because you're working in a booth and you don't realize you get a taste of people's personality because on Facebook everyone's out there and they're so you get an idea of what people are like, I think. But when you meet them face to face, it's a warm and wonderful and hugely supportive group of people that I'm honored to be a part of. And I mean that completely. They are the nicest damn bunch of people you'd ever going to want to meet. I mean, there's always exceptions. There's some jerks I can name now, but I won't. But for the most part, they're wonderful people. And it's just a great time to get together and see them all. And as a matter of fact, the sad thing is we're together in all these events and you almost don't get to see half the people you want to, except to say hello, because it's everyone's vying for attention. And certainly at the APAC conference, when you chat, some of the publishers are friends of mine, so I'll be trying to talk to them. So I'm advancing the Dan Zed from Penguin Random House. We're chatting, and all of a sudden, people saw Dan. He's gigantic. You know, he's like 6'12", I think. just inundated with people to say hello to him. I'm like, well, And a lot of people kind of just crash a conversation. Right. And I always wonder about that. Let if we're talking about something, I could tell you, I'm going to lose my leg in a skiing accident. I'm going to talk to you about it. And somebody goes, hey, I want to meet you. Just jump right in. So it's kind of weird. People don't always get a good feel for the room before they jump in there. And I wonder if they shouldn't think more about that.
Yeah. Now you were telling me you got yourself an Airbnb for there, and what happened there?
First and last, I'm gonna tell you. Yeah, I think you and I talked earlier today. Hillary Huber, a great person. She put these photos up of some. I think she stayed in, I don't know, in a museum or something. Her place was amazing. So I had booked a room at a hotel like a regular human being, and then Joanna Perrin said she wasn't coming. So I said, all right, well, let me save some loot and go to an Airbnb. And then she said she was coming. I said, well, I can't get the hotel back. So we go to the Airbnb, and I don't want to give too much away, but it was like your apartment in sophomore year before you've declared your major. It's like one bed that had the support, the same support system you get if you stack up a bunch of boxes of wet shredded wheat and lay it on it. And it was dirty, and the blinds were broken, and the radiator was on. I mean, just on. It was 120 degrees easy.
But was it within walking distance of the conference?
Oh, it was a fabulous place. No, not at all. No, it wasn't. It was a river north, which is, I don't want to be by the conference. That's McCormick Place. There's not much there of interest to me. But it was not good. So right. I got all my money back, as a matter of fact. Oh, we had to go to another place. It was the weirdest bunch of accommodations I've ever seen in my life. We ended up in some sort of hotel/hostel that had, we got a room with four bunk beds. I guess we needed two other friends we didn't know well. It was like a European train. It was weird.
I have been pretty lucky with Airbnb. I really have. I have not had, the only bad thing that's ever happened to me is like it got canceled like the day before. And I had to scramble and find something, but I've been lucky.
Yeah. Oh, Lauren McDonald McCullough lived above me. She was in the Airbnb just above us, and I think she and her husband, one of the two. There weren't three people. There were two people. I don't know. they got evicted the day of APEC, as I understand it. She was at the conference, and the landlord came and threw them out because it was an Airbnb that shouldn't have been. So there's a tricky thing. I'm no longer a fan unless I get Hillary Huber to set it up.
If I had two bad experiences, I would say I'm no longer a fan. I've had one. Yeah. I'm still hopeful, but yeah, I would feel the same way.
The one in Vegas was nice. Anyway, so you're at the conference the day before you do a splendiferous talk about audiobooks of some sort?
No, it's not a talk. It started, this is Johnny Heller's second annual splendiferous workshop. Splendiferous narrator workshop.
Cool. Tell us about it.
In New York, a number of actors had asked me if I would put something on the day before APEC, because everybody's in town with nothing to do. So I put together a room. We had like 60 people, and I had about, nine coaches. And I set up panel discussions, and it wasn't adhered to a tight agenda, but about stuff everyone needs to know and information. It was really a wonderful experience. So we did it again in Chicago, and I spent a lot of time trying to find the right space. We had a beautiful theater auditorium space, and I'd catered breakfast and lunch, and Edge Studio helped sponsor it. It was wonderful of them. We had about 120 people. The coaches, we had Scott Brick and Simon Vance, Jeff Kafer, we had to forget people, Andy Art, Tavia Gilbert, Amy Rubinate, Hillary Huber.
Wow.
I missed it. So anyway, there's like 10 of us, and we did different, everybody had different things they knew. Oh, PJ Auckland, different things we knew about. And then 9 students won a lottery to be coached in front of everybody on a piece. So it was divided up. It was just, I think everybody really enjoyed it, and I'm looking forward. I'm already working on a splendiferous number 3 here in New York again. But it was a real wonderful, it's a fact. And then after that night, you go to the APA mixer, and then there was a party that Terry Schnobel set up on the next night. And then we have Jeffrey Kafer and I put together the Naughties, which is not in competition with the audience. It's where you go if you're not going to the audience, and where you go when the audience are done.
It's
a big ass party. It was great. It
turns into the after party.
It does. Well, there wasn't. I started it about 4 years ago because it was an after party, and the company, I don't want to name names, the company stopped doing it, and nobody had anything set up. So I kind of stepped into the breach. We started doing this, and it's become a fun thing, and everybody seems to enjoy it. And it's just anytime you get a group of people of this level of swellness together, it's just a great thing. They're just great people.
Just a good idea of scale. How well attended? 200, 300, 500?
Which?
The APAC conference as a whole. How about how many people?
I think APAC this year was in Chicago, and I think they were concerned that numbers would be down. Mm-hmm. But I would say they probably, I'm not positive. I'm sure that they had a well over 200 people.
Oh, okay, yeah.
So attendees, well over.
Similar in scale to a lot of the voiceover conferences that are out there.
Absolutely, yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, it's kind of like you almost have to attend.
Mm-hmm.
Not everybody, but a lot of people get work that might not get work otherwise, and you get to meet people who provide the work. It's hard to meet these people because, especially if you live in, you know, Sheboygan or something, and they're in New York or LA or wherever they may be, so it's hard to get them to know you.
Yeah, so that pressing the flesh is definitely advantageous, huh?
Absolutely. If you have nice flesh, it's nice. I would not.
But the only reason to go to a conference is
that's right.
Pressing lots of flesh.
Flesh pressing.
Anyway, now, how big an industry is the voice, the audiobook business? I mean, we talk about it on the show a lot. It's, and you know, if you watch PBS at all, if you're watching, you know, Masterpiece Theater, and it's sponsored by Audible, and they make it sound like there's a lot of books out there.
It's, conservatively, I'd say a shitload.
that's pretty accurate, I think. Yeah, we really don't give a crap.
It is the internet.
Yes.
I think that when I started in the business, and it was pretty early in the business, it was probably a multi-million dollar industry. And now it's easily a multi-billion dollar industry. There are more and more audiobooks being produced, more and more producers. The APA has a regular, you can go to their site, apa.org, and there's a list of the numbers you can get it, and it's really amazing. There's sites like ACX where books go to be made if they're not bought by public first-rate publishers, and it's there are just a lot of books being done and a lot of opportunities for actors to get into the business. So I would say that the business has, I think, mathematical term is called quadrinkled since I got in.
I gotta write that one down.
Yeah, it's quadrinkled. It's a little known number, but it's been an amazing ride, and it's just gigantic. And I don't know if the way I got in, I don't think it's even available anymore.
Probably not.
Yeah, it's a different world. And now people have to do a lot of different things that I don't know if I would be able to or willing to do now.
Well, you've been doing it for a while now, and you're a coach as well. And coaching is very, very important if you want to get into a certain business, especially in voiceover or audiobooks or narrating. And finding the right coach is pretty important. Now, what is your coaching process like? If someone says, I want you to teach me how to do this a little better, coach, how do you help somebody become a better audiobook narrator?
I've probably been coaching for 15 to 20 years, both in audiobook and commercial voiceover, because that's what I do for a living, both of those. And I work now exclusively with Edge Studio. So you got to call there to get me. We Skype and do things all over. The process, I like to deal with I hate to say the word student, but the actor from wherever they are. Some come in with a great deal of experience and ability. Either they're really good off the back and just off the bat and just need some direction, or they don't quite, or they have more and more people come in telling me what a great voice people tell them they have. And I wait expectantly to hear it. And a lot of times, here's the essence, whether it's commercial voiceover or audiobook or any kind of any acting, you have, and I say it, people have heard me say this, you have one job, and that's to be a conduit for the author's truth. And I don't care if it's a commercial for Comet Cleanser or To Kill a Mockingbird, it's always a storytelling job, and your job is to share the truth of the author all the time and stay in touch. So my process is to see where you are first, to see what your expectations are and see where you are, and then work with you to whatever the next level would be. Some people, just like an acting class, will have major league jumps, and other people will spend a long time trying to get it right. Many people think, for example, in commercial acting, that a big, loud, bombastic voice is what they need, like they're announcing the Sunday drag races. Sometimes people come to the audiobook world and they ask questions like, do I need to read the book first? And that tells me where they are, which is not ready to be an audiobook narrator. Yeah, you have to, but if you're listening, yes, you should probably read the book first. It's always good to have an idea about where the story's going before you tell it.
And you should also probably be a consumer of audiobooks themselves,
so
right?
Glad like, you said that.
You should listen to the damn thing. I mean, I've had people, you know, ask me how to record one, right? They're getting their first book, and I teach them the whole process. And I'm like, so you've listened to one, right, before? No, I haven't. I should, huh? Yeah.
Well, yeah, George, you've seen this. This is, when people come and say that, it's because somebody told them they have a nice voice. And because you guys and everybody listening knows and watching knows, there's a bunch of equipment so anybody can buy the stuff they need to record and record well. It doesn't mean you're any good at it.
Mm-hmm.
You've got to listen. You should listen to see, especially if you want to listen, if you're a female or male, listen to female or male narrators and see who are working. I've done 600 books. George Goodall's done 1,000. Sorry, you can hear the, I live in New York City. Someone committed.
Yeah, it sounds like New York.
Yeah. Apparently someone's done something wrong. That's weird. That never happens. So you need to read the book. You need to listen to audiobooks because that's the business you want to get into. It's not just having a good voice. That's almost, I don't care what your voice, I mean, unless you have a lisp or if you're not like that, then I think you can do the job, but you're going to have to read the book and you're going to have to realize it's an acting job first and foremost. And you certainly need to listen to some audiobooks so you know what the job is.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. Now, let's talk a little bit about playing characters in an audiobook, because that's probably one of the biggest challenges that people have is you've got different characters in a fiction novel, and do you act out each character? Is it different with each book? Do they give you direction of how they want this? But how do you play characters?
Because you're almost directorless anymore, you're self-directed almost all the time. That's one of the biggest differences since I got in the business. No one will tell you pretty much. So it's got to be your acting prowess and ability. And here's what you do with character, basically. And it's the same characters in kids' books and young adult books and middle grade books, maybe a little broader, but they're all based on the text, what the author wrote. The same, and people have an idea what to do in a play, in a script, or if they're playing a Willie Loman from Death of a Salesman, that you know they know they write they have a whole backstory about this guy. Well, if you're doing the book Death of a Salesman, not the play, but you're doing everybody, you're playing everybody. What I suggest is you write down every character you come across in your book. Just write it down, and I believe that narrating a book is much the same as reading it, in that we visualize what the author is saying. We see it and I believe that we cast the book ourselves with whatever voice we give in our mind. That's the voice we give as an actor. And for example, let me be as clear as I can be. Let's say your character is Steve Smith, and he is a New Englander, and you write down. I write down Steve Smith, and he comes across to me in the author's text as a snooty or snobby New Englander. Okay? Now, that can be anybody from one of the Kennedys or to Mayor Quimby on The Simpsons, depending on how far I want to go. But I would argue that we all know thousands and thousands and thousands of people, both from watching Avengers movies and from being alive. You know what I mean? You've seen every movie. You've seen every TV show. There's a million actors. If I say this is a Johnny Depp kind of guy, if I say it's a Clint Eastwood kind of guy, if I say it's your Uncle Fred, everything I say or that you think of will have a different image and it'll change. You don't have to impersonate Clint Eastwood, but it's going to give your read a different feel if you think this is a Clint Eastwood kind of guy. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I think once you set them up like that, and as long as your choices are true to the text, it'll be just fine. And I think if your choices are not true to the text, I always tell my students that you will know it's not true because you'll start screwing up words like cat and the. If things start going wrong, you've made an incorrect choice, and that's the beauty of the digital thing. You can fix that right away.
Very cool. All right, we're going to take a quick break here, and we've got a couple more questions, talk about nonfiction and a few other things with Johnny Heller from Edge Studios and talking about audiobooks and stuff. So don't go away. We'll be right back here on VoiceOver Body Shop.
Learning never ends.
You continue to grow.
Edge Studio has grown. Pursue multiple disciplines in tandem and grow your career. We've added new courses in a new curriculum.
We pick the best coaches from the community of working voice actors.
A new technology division, engineering and consulting, led by George Whittem.
Follow your dream.
Sign up for advanced learning or register for an introduction to voice acting or foundation studies program.
See it all now
at thenewedgestudio.com.
All right, let's talk about VO2GoGo.com. Everything you need to be a successful voiceover artist. Everything you could possibly know. David H. Lawrence the 17th apparently has it in this large stack of material that he likes to get across to his students at VO2GoGo.com. It's 36 classes online or in person across a year-long course featuring not just classes in the art of voiceover, but also in the commerce and science of running your voiceover business. So, in each month's class day includes a workout class for all participants. Now, you know, VO2GoGo.com's voiceover curriculum is a 5-time winner of Backstage Magazine's Reader's Choice Award for Best Voiceover Classes and Best Voiceover Teacher, our good friend David H. Lawrence, the 17th. Ooh. Now, in May, which is the month we are in, almost halfway through, we are halfway through the month of May. But in May, VO2GoGo students will master how to master, the art of cold reading of voiceover scripts and learn how to voice both news and information, voiceover and IVR and phone prompts.
Okay. That's pretty heavy-duty stuff in one month.
You have called for information, dial zero. It's actually kind of cool stuff. Mm-hmm. Get more details and sign up for the pro membership to save money at VO2GoGo.com/VOBS. That's VO2GoGo.com/VOBS for a great discount and a pro membership. VO2GoGo.com. Everything, absolutely everything you need to be a successful voiceover artist.
A VO gig in 7 years, and your demo is so old that you can hear the clicks from the stock music records, and you hear so much tape hiss that you run to the sink to see if the faucet is running, and the engineer used so much echo on your voice that it sounds like it was recorded in the Grand Canyon, and the scripts seem a bit dated too. Advertising the new and improved 1938 Plymouth Road King? Is that what's been troubling you, Bunky?
Well, lift your head up high and take a walk in the sun. Your demo can be killer, too. Just contact Uncle Roy at atlandproductions.com and book yourself a shiny new killer demo. Show your stick-to-itiveness and show the world. You'll never give up, never give up, never give up. That dream.
All right, we're back here on VoiceOver Body Shop with Johnny Heller, audiobook narrator extraordinaire and coach. And you coach and you do, you know, more than just audiobooks. Your full-time job, as you said, you're doing commercials as well. So you're auditioning all the time and doing all that kind of stuff too, right?
Oh, yeah. I'm a SAG-AFTRA union actor, so I don't have, I think a lot of commercials, a lot of voice courses come up, a lot of non-union stuff now, so I can't do that stuff. But I'm with Abrams Artists in New York, and I started in commercial voiceover, and I still do quite a bit of it, and I coach a lot in that as well. And actually, George, I think, brought up earlier in the program the idea of how audiobook narrators tend to be sometimes just in the audiobook world, and other people say e-learning, just in e-learning. I think there's a lot more crossover and a lot more desire to crossover, because initially you think voiceover. Geez, what can I do? Well, there's commercials. That's the first thing you think of because that's there. Then you think audiobook. That's big. But there's a million things. I know Tom Deere is big in the e-learning world, and there's corporate narration, and there's animation and video games. And I think that I think for the actor, as with the advent of home studio and home studio technology that you guys deal so well in, there's a lot more opportunities for the actor, but a lot more knowledge is needed. A lot, like I put together an e-learning demo that just blows, and I'm going to change it and fix it. I'm going to take some workshops in it and learn a little more about it because, you know, it's different than what I do.
How do you know it blows? I'm just not to know.
I'm doing an awful lot of e-learning here.
How do you know that your demo is not great?
Tom Deere said, yeah, and I trust him.
There you go. That's all you need.
I'm going to say it blows, but I'm certain I can do better with some instruction. I thought personally I was brilliant, but apparently I'm not. Right. So yeah. I'm going to fix it. But it is something I don't know enough about. And so I'm going to take some classes in it. And I think here's the thing. Jessica, I've done 600 or so audiobooks, and I know I've done tons of commercials. I know what I'm doing. I work at it. And I think that doesn't mean that I know how to do everything else. Brad Venable, a friend of mine out in Dallas, and Pat Fraley, for God's sakes, all kinds of animated stuff. That doesn't, just because he does it, doesn't mean, I said, I can do that too. It doesn't mean, it's not the same thing.
Yeah.
I can't swim like Phelps. I can't ski like Peekaboo. I mean, there are things you can't do.
Yeah.
But if you want to learn how to do those things, you need to, like, I don't know anything about the tech stuff you guys do. I'm literally a technical Luddite. I know nothing, nothing. So if I want to know what George does and George is willing to show me, I'd be an idiot not to study with.
Oh, absolutely. And with e-learning, there's a lot of e-learning courses on how to do e-learning.
Absolutely. And so, I'm going to start. My problem is, actors lament, I'm actually very busy. I don't have much time to pick up other occupations right now, but I want to. I do a lot of courses and acting and stuff, to take courses and workshops and monologues and things, but I haven't found the time to do the other things. And fortunately, I'm busy enough that it's not mandatory right now. But I think it'd be... And I think even the e-learning demo I put out, I think that was presumptuous of me to do so without the training I need. And I that's a decision I regret right now. I mean, it's not awful, but it could be great. And I should have made it great. You should be great first. Because as I tell people, you have one chance to make your first impression. And here's me not even taking my own advice. Shame on me.
Well, e-learning is an interesting thing because it requires acting, because it is acting, and it requires knowing what it is that the director wants. Do they want you to be a presenter? Do you want them to be, they want you to be one of the guys telling everybody else how to do stuff? It's very, very different. And, but again, it's awful. It's a lot like audiobooks, but it's also nonfiction, which was the next thing we really wanted to talk about. There's a lot of opportunity with nonfiction books as opposed to reading fiction and all those characters and stuff. I've done like 40 nonfiction titles myself. And, It's a totally different read. And there are a lot of people who probably do nonfiction that probably would really blow at doing fiction. How is it different?
Well, it's different. And first off, the story is different, and there are rarely, well, there are characters, but they're generally real life characters. For example, I just did, I think the last four books I did were nonfiction. I just did a police procedural. I did a good month for murder, it was called. And it's literally all these murders in Prince George County, Maryland. And I did Katrina, a book about Katrina. And everybody in it is real. So what you have to do, and you can do other drier. I just did Patrick Kennedy's tell-all, if you will. There's just so many things. What you have to do, the same as in nonfiction. You look,
come on, baby.
Those thousands of things. That doesn't.
Johnny, your feed is breaking up. Just let's give it a second to see if it'll catch up. Hang on, just a second.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, just a minute. Just give it a second to catch up. It's kind of chunking up a little bit. Are your kids all on? Are they downloading movies right now, or is everybody playing video games?
Well, Jacob's doing his thing.
No, at Johnny's.
Oh, John, hey, I got all your...
I don't have any kids.
Oh, okay, good.
It's not them. Sure. Yeah.
Must be the neighbors poaching your Wi-Fi. Actually, you're good now, man.
God forbid I procreate. No.
You're good now, though. It's fine. Okay. So, sorry. Pick up the last story.
I don't know where the hell I was. All right.
Sorry, so, talking about nonfiction.
Under the general umbrellas of fiction and nonfiction are tons of genres. But when you talk about nonfiction, what you need, what you can play as an actor, and Paul Allen Rubin speaks rather eloquently with very large words about this. That is, whoever wrote the book, and let's say it's a book about A Good Month for Murder, or it's a book about Katrina. The book about Katrina I did had everything to do with the racism that went on in the rescue events. Just tragic, and something I had no idea about. Now, there's emotional stuff going on here, and in A Good Month for Murder, emotional stuff going on here. But the only thing you can play as the actor are the feelings, the emotions. So you have to get into the enthusiasm and the excitement with which the author approaches his subject. And the subject can be as dry as the exciting world of iPhone cases. Or it could be about, I read a book for Hachette about first dads, presidents in the White House who raised their had children while in the White House and raised their kids in the White House, all the different kinds of presidents. And the guy spent, the author spent a long time researching and writing. I did a book by John Bacon about Michigan, University of Michigan football. The man lives and breathes that subject. For him, it's everything. I can play his emotional connection to that material. And that's what the actor has to find. So you're not playing characters. In the book with the presidents, well, I do a kick-ass Bill Clinton. My James K. Polk is not so great. So you can't play one guy and not the others. So all you can do is suggest a character based on the author's text, and you can't do your Obama impersonation and not do your George Bush. You have to make choices. So you've got to just play the characters, the author, and they're real people. So give them the respect they deserve for what they have to say, and play the author's emotional connection to them. Play the feelings that you can play. You can't play, the tree was rather large. There's nothing to play there. You just share that truth.
Right.
But the author's excited about that. That's what you can play.
Yeah. And there's great opportunity with doing nonfiction stuff. A lot of autobiographies and biographies. It's there's tremendous amounts out there. One other thing, you wanted to talk about audiobook reviews.
Oh, right. Because on the Facebook that the kids are on.
The kids.
That's, the kids. You know,
yeah.
The kids.
And anybody over 30 is now on Facebook, and yeah, everybody they're somewhere else. So.
If they're under 30, I talked to someone the other day at a party. I'm such an idiot. We're talking about something. I said, I really enjoy, it was Katie Ostrowski from Harper, I think. And she has these great, great, interesting pictures on Instagram. And I said, well, are you on the pin interest also? I didn't know it wasn't called that. It seemed to make sense to me. I didn't know it was called Pinterest. She started laughing, think it was a joke, but I'm actually, that's stupid. On Facebook, you see a lot of people will put reviews, and most of the reviews they put up seem to come from Audible or Amazon, mostly from Audible. And it's always nice to have someone validate what you've done as an actor. However, if it says Johnny Heller did such a sterling job with his recent reading of Huckleberry Finn that I cried, I recommend this book to everyone. Signed, Johnny's mom. See, the last part of it hurts the credibility of the review. And I think it has to be understood that most times people, like you can have review. I know a girl had a review. One reviewer said, she sounds like a bucket of puke. And I was thinking, well, that's a tough sound to capture. And
it just sits there on the floor.
Yeah, really.
Motionless. Just,
yeah, the actual puking maybe, but the bucket. So anyway, so how does that review help anyone? I think I argue that a lot of reviews are people just getting crap off their chest. It's the same people who bitch about a dirty fork at the Four Seasons or something, you know? They write this horrible review about how badly they were treated. Or on the opposite, they write a great review. When your friend tells you, George, Dan, you guys, you got to try this restaurant. You live in, Santa Monica or whatever. You go down the Pacific Coast Highway a little bit. It's right there, you know? and you might try it because you like me and you say, geez, let's go there. Or if I said the opposite, for God's sakes, don't go see Superman versus Batman. You'll never get the 3 hours back. Don't do it. So maybe you won't go. And in fact, that's probably true. So I think the reviews, you've got to be careful what you're sharing. And some of these people share, I just got a wonderful review for my work in a book. And I go look, and I will look, and it's just somebody who read their book. I would say reviews from actual critics, from Audiophile magazine, from Booklist, from Publishers Weekly, from audiobook bloggers. And how do you get those? Well, you can start a relationship. Interesting enough, I will tell you, if you're listening, audiobook bloggers, you can find out where they are. You can find websites, and you send them notes. If you send them the codes or the books, would you mind reviewing this? They probably will, because it's a free book. You can also work with your author or publisher and get the books out to people for review. Make yourself available, and I think you'll find, and as long as you actually truly don't suck, you can probably get some nice reviews that have some more validity. I do know certain publishers will not pay much attention to an actor who has less than 3 stars overall in Audible.
Right.
So, and I will find a lot of times I've got some horrible written reviews. Like some, this, oh my God, Heller. I got one that says I sound like Gabby Hayes. And then I don't. And then another one that says my youthful, whiny voice. I'm like, you can't have both those. And then, but then I get 5 stars. So overall, people liked it, except for this schmo who has a computer and a keyboard.
Right.
So be aware of how much, I guess I'm saying, be aware of how much validity you put into some of these good and some of these bad reviews. Although the bad reviews I find pretty funny sometimes.
Do you think you've ever gained work from a review? Like, have you ever had someone say, you know what, I read your reviews and I decided to hire you?
No.
I'm just curious.
No. I've had people hire me from, not from the pin interest, but I've been hired from the Facebook.
Yeah.
People get out there. And you also, word of mouth helps a great deal, but I'm not sure. I think if you get a positive review in Booklist, Publishers Weekly, and you show that, I think that, here's what you have to remember, the publishers who you want to meet or want to work for are pretty much also either they or one of their minions is on Facebook. And if you have some good reviews they weren't aware of, I'll be honest with you, as soon as I find reviews from other people, other actor friends of mine, and I'll send it to them, and I may even send it to their publisher. Listen, I just found a good review for one of your people. I don't know if you saw this. And they appreciate that. That's kind of a good turn. So they think that Johnny Heller's not a bad guy. He's not selling himself. He's selling his friend Robert Fass, who I'll tell you right now, it's got a good review in Booklist just now. I have it right in front of me. So when I share that with Robert and his publisher, that's good for both of them. And it's good karma and good for me, because I'm perceived as a fellow who's sharing good news about others, because I spread the happy gospel of audiobooks.
Sure.
Yeah. Let's go to the shot with Johnny behind us here.
Oh yeah. It's that time of the show where we pull out this shot.
The technology shot. See, and we just sort of behind us and there you are. And this is the shot we'll use for our audience question segment, I think, tonight. Just scratch right here, actually.
Maybe that's supposed to show. Better. Yeah. Okay. Squishing your head.
Okay. We got questions from our audience here, and let's start off with Paul Stefano, who asks, how does a narrator go from commanding lower paid for finished hour rate to something more union scale?
Well, work for union publishing house does for one thing. If you accept a shitty rate, if you accept a rate that's below union minimum, you have, I'm thinking, who can you blame? Yeah, that would be you. You determine that. Now, if you're an ACX and it's a royalty share, you can do that on a union deal if you get at least $100 stipend. I think to do a union rate on ACX, it has to be $225 or $235 a finished hour, which isn't enough to produce the book anyway. If you're willing to work for $50 a finished hour, well, then, you know, I'm sorry, then you have yourself to, that's a stupid thing to do. Especially if you're doing the editing and mastering as well, because in the industry, it's about 2 hours of work for one finished hour. That's the average. If you're doing your own editing and mastering, you're looking at 5 or 6 or 7 to 1, depending on how facile you are. And on that point, real quickly, I would also recommend that You don't be your own master editor. Send it to professionals who do that for a living, because that's their art. That's what they're good at. Your job should be an actor. But to answer your question, don't take, the way to get out of taking bad money is don't take bad money. Royalty shares, I understand. Take a look. If you like the book, there's money to be made in those hills. You can make some money, keep going. And I understand, but I think we're past the time in our lives we can say, yeah, I was in college and I needed the work. I think you're going to have to fess up and just say, look, I'm willing. If you say, I'm going to accept $50 an hour, you know what you're worth? $50 an hour. You set the value. And as soon as you set a value that that's bad, mm-hmm. you bring down the whole industry. You really do. The union has worked very hard to get minimum wage, fair minimum wages, almost at every publishing house. And even if you're not union, you get that wage. So there.
All right.
First question?
You get the next
one. All right. Paul from Shelley. Sorry. Question. When you were doing lots of characters in an audiobook, how do you personally keep them consistent? I keep them in separate files. Do you do the same thing, or is there another way? And that's from Shelley Avellino.
There's a couple of ways that I know of, and George should be able to speak better. This is with Dan. I use Pro Tools and I record, and there's something called a bookmark. Mm-hmm. So if I'm doing, now this is, I'm doing Dan Leonard. So I do my Dan Leonard voice and I bookmark it. And so when Dan Leonard comes up again, I can go back. What I like, now, if let's say it's a typical fiction book, there's probably two or three main characters. You probably don't have to keep track of them because they're there all the time. All the other characters are smaller characters, and there could be many, 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 you want to keep track of. And the way I like to do it is with my smartphone. When I get the voice I want, I go to my voice memos. I don't know if it'll play on this thing. I don't need to play it. I'll show you. Here's voice memos. And if I go through here.
That memo sounded a lot like a 1997 Chevy.
I can't do it. I write down, let's say, like, it says voices. Let's say, like, Mayor Frank Pandini, a recurring character in the exciting Platypus Police Squad novels. And so I've got him. He comes in. So I know he'd come back. So I've got 1,000. I've probably got 500 different characters in my phone here, just in case. Because one thing to remember, too, is if you do a book, sometimes you don't know that part two or part three is coming up. So sometimes your choices, be careful with the choices. If you play a character, it's going to hurt your voice. He's in 16 books. You've made a huge error. So I keep track of them. Either almost every recording software available has a bookmarking feature. And I certainly think almost every smartphone available has a voice memo recorder. And that's just handier, but it's in both places. And I keep all my books I've done on a backup, a hard drive backup, so I can call it back up if I have to.
Smart idea. Question from Facebook, our first Facebook question.
Cool.
Someone watched. Is that still working, by the way?
It died. Oh. It came on. It worked, and then it went away, then it came back, and then it died a smelly death.
All right. Anyway, well, someone was watching on Facebook, and hopefully they've come back here.
Yeah.
From Joey Pontania, mm-hmm. who I bet you I pronounced that proper.
Hey, Joey.
Hey, hey. Pantanilla, Pantanilla, whatever.
Yeah.
If you're from Southern California or if you're from Jersey. Regarding ACX, how strict are they regarding noise floor? Their max is minus 60 dB, but I can't seem to get mine lower than 40 dB. Well, he's in a lot of trouble. That's more of our question, I think.
Yeah.
Well,
I don't know.
Yeah, don't record from your apartment in New York.
That would be number one.
Well, I did record from here. I have a whisper room, though.
Ah, well, yeah, not from your living room, of course. Yeah.
No, whisper room, not where I am right now, no.
A whisper room will cut it down, your noise, by about 20 to 40 dB, depending on, you know, where you started from. That could be enough. Audible? Audible specs, ACX specs, they're kind of one and the same in terms of specs. Minus 60 dB RMS is what they're looking for room tone. So that's not nearly as stringent as minus 60 dB peak. Okay, so that's something you should know. A lot of people get those confused and don't know the difference. But if you're at minus 40 dB peak, you still got some work to do. Now, a lot of that could be rumble.
Yeah,
that's that low frequency garbage that's in the waveform. So if you hit record, stop talking and just look at the waveform in that room tone. If there's a pretty big up and down jaggedy line, chances are that's just rumble.
Right.
And that can be filtered out with a high pass EQ. thing in there, either in the mic or the preamp or the software. If that's all it is, you might be able to drop it down a ton by just applying one filter, fixed.
And you won't be affecting your voice at all because it's below the range of your voice.
Exactly. If that's the case for you, you might be in luck. If that's not the case for you, then there might be a lot more going on, and then you need to check in with one of us. And we'll figure out what's going on. But good question.
Yeah. All righty. Carol Spencer Morgan asks, question, what is your advice for anyone going from commercial voiceover to narration?
Oh, excellent. My advice is think of your commercial work as a very short story. Commercials are 15, 30, 45, or 60 seconds typically. An audiobook, let's say a typical book is 10 to 12 hours. So you're still sharing a story, just longer story. So the advice is, and also the commercial characters are drawn quickly with a broad stroke, while in audiobooks, they're a much finer artwork, if you will, a much finer stroke. And I think that you need to spend some time sharing the author's story. As long as you immerse yourself in the story and in telling the story, the differences aren't major. But you can also bring down, it's not quite as presentational as some commercials may be.
Sorry, mic was off.
Yeah.
Apologies. Oh, yeah, John? There's one from John. Is that the one I'm on?
Let's see here. Yes, it
John
is.
Oak, sorry. John Oak. That's what happens when we multitask. Sorry about that.
Yeah.
We are the producers as well as the actors.
Which reminds us, we need a floor producer here. We're still looking for one.
John says, how do you move from ACX to the name publishers? So I guess it's kind of like that. Yeah, how do you make that transition?
How do you go from the Bush leagues to the major leagues, I guess?
Well, first off, a couple of things. Well, this comes up in the Splendiferous Workshop.
Of course it does.
It comes up everywhere because so many actors are finding their chance to work in ACX. And once they're there, they want to break into what they consider the big time. And I think there is a perception that exists, but is slowly eroding, that ACX is the minor leagues, you know, the AA and AAA, if I'm using a baseball thing. As opposed to the major leagues. One thing is to do really good work consistently. Just because you are toiling, if I may, in the ACX world, doesn't mean you have any right to do less than a brilliant job of sharing your author's truth. Understand that some of the books in ACX are fabulous. They just didn't get picked up by a publisher. If you do well and get it out there in time, the brilliance of your work will get to the publishers. You have to put together a winning demo, and you have to be a decent human being and get in touch with the publishers. And in time, you will. If you go to the various functions that are available to you, if you get into the Facebook forums and chat, I would suggest you take a look at, let's say, look at Recorded Books here in New York. Go to their website and see if there's something that says, here's how we want you to contact us. And then it gives you a play-by-play, here's what we want you to do. And then you don't do that. Well, then that's a problem. Mm-hmm. If there's no advice as to how to contact us, I guarantee someone at every publishing house casts. There's no reason not to send them a hello note. I've done this, this, and this. You don't have to send your entire book. I've done 20, 30 great titles in ACX, to fairly good reviews, and I'd really like to get to work for you. Why don't you single out a few of those people and work? Not like, don't be jerky, but how would you like to be approached? Send them a little note. I'm Johnny Heller. I've done some work. I'd really love the chance to audition for you or perhaps do a title for you. I believe I'm good at these sorts of genres, and you tell them, I'd love to do this sort of thing. If you'd like, I'd be happy to send you a demo. So introduce yourself. I always like to send an introductory note and then follow it up with my demo, because that gives me two chances to say hello and get my face there, that kind of thing. It's not easy, and that's what I said, it wouldn't be. It's harder now to do than when I started, no question, but it is doable because people do it every damn day. And the casting people at the publishing houses, their job is to listen to you and to find you and to hire you. So they're not mad at you for doing it.
Good advice.
Yeah.
Steve Gonzalez asks, something happens at the end of a series which affects how the character is to be portrayed at the beginning. How do you handle it? Does the author help you with some sort of info at the beginning?
Nope.
Ooh.
That's when you read the book.
I was going to say, it might be a good idea time to read it.
See, if you're playing your lead character like a black jazz musician from Harlem, and then you find out he's a leprechaun from County Cork at the end, you should have read that. You know, you should have seen that coming. You've got to. Now, on the other hand, if you've read book one of something and you've done this guy, and then in book two you find out he's a New Orleans blind Dixie jazz player or something, well, it's not your fault, because book two wasn't available for you. You know, you didn't know. But in any given book, there's enough clues to what you're supposed to be. If you find at the end the guy's not what you played, that's on you. Now, you can get in touch with the author, assuming he's not dead, and they don't mind. You get in touch. I'm curious. I'm doing your new book. I want to make sure that my take on your lead character, Melvin, is not crazy. I'm playing him like an insane person. Is that right for you? You know, let him know, and then he'll talk to you. But beware, when you open the door to that, it's a Pandora's box.
Yeah.
And you could have a whole lot of direction that you don't need. The author wrote the book. That was his job. Good for him. Your turn to act.
Ooh, that's a good point. I wouldn't have thought of that. D-Vox.
D-Vox asks, let's see, we were just talking about communicating with the author, but is there anything you've learned recently about the process of recording audiobooks, no matter how arcane, that you feel has made you better at it?
Anything that I've recently learned?
Just a trick. You're like, man, 20 years later, this is a great idea. Eureka.
I think now there is a bigger movement, and I just kind of mentioned it, to get in touch with the rights holder or author. And I've done that a lot, not necessarily for acting advice as much as when I get a new book, I like to, and Audible even has you do it as part of their deal. You've got to do it. But I like to send it. Listen, a guy named Todd Goldberg, he did a book called Gangsterland, really excellent book. I got a nice write-up for it. He's a really good guy. And I got in touch with him and I said, listen, I'm doing your book and I want to tell you it's a fabulous book. I'm just really happy to have read it. And I've said that to him. If I don't like the book, I'm not going to bullshit the guy. But I'm not going to say I don't like it either. But if I like it, I'll say, this is a really good book. I'm so happy you read it and I got a chance to be your guy. And you can start a relationship. And I think that's meant the world. I have some friends now who are authors and we correspond and it's all via Twitter and Facebook and stuff. And it's really nice. I mean, I can name a bunch of guys and girls with whom I'm friendly because I was fortunate enough to be the actor hired to narrate their books. And that wasn't, I never got a hold of anybody before. I just took the job for granted. I no longer do that.
Oh, yeah. Mm. Do not take the job for granted.
Yeah. So now I got to lean to get your face back in there. And okay.
I don't have an angle. I can't figure this out.
You're good. Right there. Yep. A little to your left. There you go. Stop. Okay, perfect. See, I should be a director. All righty. Anyway, Johnny, it is fabulous having you on the show tonight, and you've offered us a lot of really valuable information for especially people trying to get into audiobooks or doing it and that sort of thing, and we really appreciate you being on. How can they get a hold of you to be taught by you?
The best way to get a hold of me, to be taught by me.
We're back.
I'm back. Edge Studio. Contact Edge Studio. Oh, yeah, I'm going the wrong way. This way. I'm not stupid thing. Yeah, wait, cut it out. Edge Studio. I'm not hidden. I'm at johnnyheller.com is my website. MrJohnnyHeller@gmail.com is my email. But if you want me to coach you or work with you, you've got to get me through Edge. I no longer do it myself because it just became too cumbersome.
Cumbersome.
I love Edge and I love how they do things and they take care of all my scheduling. So that's how you get me, but I'd be happy to hear from you.
Great. Well, thanks for being with us. And of course we'll see you soon somewhere.
Okay. Thank you.
Come join us out here on the coast.
I will. That's planned. That's going to happen.
Excellent.
Thanks, Johnny.
Thanks. Stay there for a bit.
Yeah, you can leave anytime you want.
Anytime you want. You're not beholden to us. But
and he kicks back.
Yeah, that's right. So anyway, someone we are beholden to, because he's been with us a long time, is Harlan Hogan.
Indeed.
At voiceoveressentials.com. And you have to go to the website right now, George. Show him the website, because they've got a new website.
They do.
They do. They've totally redesigned it, and it's simple and clean and responsive, a very responsive website. It looks great on your desktop computer. Nobody uses a desktop computer anymore.
Desktop computer.
Desktop. It's suddenly 2005.
So you just got to go to our website.
Right.
Scroll to the bottom.
Right.
If you go this way in, that way he knows he came from us.
Right.
But right.
You can watch it, but it looks great on an iPad, an iPhone,
yeah.
Android tablets. And so it's mobile friendly, which I think is essential in these days, which
yes,
is why
it
is. This is VoiceOver Essentials. The thing is you can now pay with any major credit card or your PayPal account. So if you want to order something from Harlan, the Portabooth Pro, the Portabooth Plus, the rack that you hold your Portabooth on, or a VO1A, or this Signature Series headphones, or anything else he has on the website, you can pay for it now with PayPal.
Mm, nice.
And the special new website has celebration pricing.
Oh, wow.
Yes, so you can
Thanks,
get
Harlan.
Things you can get things less expensively.
All right.
There's also special bundle pricing all the time. So if you want to say like get a microphone, you might get it with a Micport Pro or something along those lines.
That's a big deal, the bundle thing.
Bundling.
Yeah.
We bundle.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it sounds completely innocuous to the buyer, but to be able to select certain items and have them shipped together as a package and with a special price is actually a pretty big deal for a small store. So
it is.
It's great that he can do that.
Yeah.
Now.
But the other thing is all of the products are on one page as opposed to, look for this. It's all there.
Yeah.
So it's easy to find. And they also provide a page of other products that Harlan recommends and provide a way to easily pop them in Amazon.com shopping cart.
There you go.
So voiceoveressentials.com, anything you could possibly ever use in voiceover is there, including Harlan, who I'm sure will be happy to voice something instead of you.
One of these days, you'll see his head on there, and he'll say, "Hire Harlan."
That's right.
Right through his website.
Exactly, exactly.
Thank you, Harlan.
All right, thank you. VoiceOverEssentials.com. Be there. All right. Well, it's time to say goodnight, but we have a few announcements.
Before we do, we got one quickie.
There was a tech question, wasn't there?
Yeah, that slipped in during the show, so I wanted to make sure we didn't miss it. Because that's why we started the show in the first
place, to answer your questions.
Yeah. So,
Michael Blaha, yeah. Yes. Okay, so I'm just putting together my modest recording space, also known as a tiny bedroom closet.
Mm-hmm.
Bad news, I can still hear the hum of my computer through the closet door. What are my best options to help lower my noise floor that's coming through the door?
It's a Dunkey Shern.
Dunkey
Shern.
I think that means thank you in,
yeah.
In German.
Auf Deutsch, right.
Yeah.
I'll start with a snarky answer, which is go get a Mac. Okay, now we've gotten that out of the way.
Yeah. Here is a MacBook Air. It doesn't make any noise.
Okay, yes, we have a gate on our stuff and everything. But trust me, you have to put your ear up to it.
I'm not hearing anything.
But no, honestly, so you might be getting noise through vibrational transmission. Like, the sound of the computer's hard drives and the fan, everything.
Right.
All that stuff is vibrating the case. The case is vibrating the floor. The sound is being transmitted up into your closet. Voila.
Right.
So you can have a nice thick door. It doesn't matter.
Right.
So get the computer on some neoprene pads or some kind of rubber feet, something that will isolate the computer from the floor.
Right. Or put it on your carpet.
Or, put on a piece of carpet or rug. Anything to damp the sound of the vibration. Or, since you are running a PC, get a new silent PC case that's designed to be quiet. All the hard drives inside are on little rubber grommets.
Oh, cool.
That shock mount them so the vibration from the hard drive doesn't get transmitted to the case. They're not that expensive. You can get a good silent case for under $200 now. Build a quieter PC. That would be my suggestion, too, if the other suggestion doesn't work.
Right. Or call us, and we can come over and figure it out for you, because we know what to listen for.
Yeah, I'll hit it with a bat.
That's right. And unplug everything.
All right. Coming up on future shows.
Next week, Juan Carlos Bagnell, some audio guy, will be with us. He's been with us before, but we'll just talk, not a tech roundtable type of thing, but we'll talk more about the casting work he does and some other cool stuff.
We'll geek out a little bit.
Well,
moderately geeky.
No, a fair amount,
yeah,
but not totally.
This much.
So for those of you tuning in for geeky stuff and tech stuff, make sure you join us next week.
Right.
May 30th, we were going to have a Memorial Day party, but that may not be, that's not going to happen. So
yeah, we're going to save the party for July 4th, right?
Yeah, there's going to be a 4th of July party. So we may be dark, that night for a number of reasons. But
exactly.
But if we actually come up with somebody, we'll figure it out.
And we always do.
Right. June 6th, Kif Vanderhoevel, who is in our whole life challenge group.
Let me respell that so it's spelled right. Vandenhoevel. Yeah.
Okay.
He's
not doing well. Not doing well in the whole life challenge, but he is on our team.
That's right. Yeah, we're all doing this whole life challenge thing together, man. Oh, and I'm not doing the great. I'm the worst on the team, actually. I think. I think I'm the last place of the team.
6 pounds in 1 week.
Which either means I'm the most honest, or I'm the worst player. One or the other.
Yeah. But one thing this diet is about drinking water.
That's right.
Okay.
At least 60 to 70 ounces a day, depending on your body weight. That's a lot of water.
Fortunately, as you get lighter, it's less. It's one of those interesting. Anyway, yeah. Kif's going to be here. He has a podcast about voiceover that he does.
He does. It's all over VO.
Cool. That's
what it's called.
All right. June 13th. Yes, I Talk for a Living. Anne Ganguza will be joining us, whether she's here in the studio or on Zoom. Joining us from Irvine, we're not exactly sure.
Mm-hmm.
June 20th, Dr. Dara J. Allen, broadcast voice coach and licensed speech language pathologist in Austin, Texas.
Nice.
So we'll talk about speech pathology so I can stop doing the stupid lisp thing. June 27th. Joyce Castellanos will be with us talking about promo, and so we'll go get back and talk a little bit about promo from another perspective.
And she will be here in studio.
She will be here.
She doesn't live that far away.
She does not. And July 4th, we're going to have a July 4th party here.
Yes.
Anyway.
All right. Thanks to our donors, Eric Aragoni, Brian Scott Kelly, Andrew Kaufman. Man, that was funny.
What?
I bumped the hydraulic lever on my chair.
Well, I could have just lowered myself, and it would have been a lot easier.
Jack DeColley of VoiceOver, C3M Productions, and David Smith. Thank you, everybody that donates to the show.
It helps. It really does. What's happening at Edge this week?
I don't know. I haven't gotten an update, but there's always something going on at Edge. If you want to be in the loop at what's up lately with them, you can follow them. The best way, really, is if you're a Twitter person, just follow them on Twitter. Go to Edge Studio on Twitter, and they're always posting. I know that because Amy, my wife, is the one doing the posting. So there's always something new going up there, and that's the best place to find out what is the latest at Edge Studio.
Cool. We're on Instagram. We're not on Pinterest, though.
No, we haven't done that one. And I haven't been on that in like 2 years. I really have not used it.
Instagram?
No, Pinterest.
Pinterest.
I haven't been on Pinterest.
I go on there occasionally.
Google Plus. When's the last time you were on Google Plus?
Google what?
Yeah, I know. At least
exactly.
A year.
Exactly.
VoiceOver Body Shop. That's our Instagram account. Yeah, VoiceOver Body
check
Shop.
Check that out. Show logs. You can access the show logs from the VOBS website in the upper right. That's going to be the upper left-hand side.
Let me double check. Let's go to the website of our own website and see. Where are you pointing again?
I'm pointing up.
There you go. You got it right.
Okay, cool.
You
all right. It's right up there.
Mm-hmm.
Even higher than up there.
Perfect.
You can try it from there. anyway, you can access the show logs there. Jack DeGolia writes every single word that was said on this show. Mm-hmm. So if you miss something, you can go back and you can find it and go back on YouTube and watch it again. The podcast.
Yeah, the podcast versions on Stitcher, iTunes, and just about anywhere you might find a podcast, you should find us. And if you don't find us where you're looking, please tell us so that we can make sure we're there by emailing us at theguys@vobs.tv. Chances are you are listening to us, because that's actually how most of you consume the show.
That is correct.
So if you would like to consume the show by video and see who some of these people are and be more interactive, then you should be here at 6 p.m. live. Pacific time, 9 p.m. Eastern time.
Every Monday night.
Every Monday night. That's right now, I think that's 1 GMT with daylight savings time.
We would like to have some people in the audience. It's getting kind of lonely in here.
Not that
I don't mind hanging out with just you, but...
No, it's fun when there's people in the audience.
It's fun when there's people here. Yeah. There's food, there's laughter, there's gaiety.
We pull out the stops.
We do.
We bring out a veggie tray.
That we do. And but it adds to the energy. If you think we're like, people come in, suddenly we're like, hey, fun. We want to perform.
Yeah, we do have chairs. We have, if the first two people that show up get the love seat, which is very cozy.
It is. It is. As long as my briefcase isn't on it. But anyway.
There's where you could be sitting, right over there.
Right over there. And so anyway, what were we talking? Oh, we were talking about if you want to be in the audience, write to us, theguys@vobs.tv. If you happen to be here in the Valley or in Los Angeles County or Orange County, even up in Ventura County.
Yeah, if you're visiting from out of town, let us know.
We'll up in the San Joaquin Valley, Sacramento, or even if you want to fly in from New York, let us know, because people have done that.
It has happened.
They have happened. Mm-hmm. I remember Dave Rosenthal flew down from San Francisco just to be here.
That was awesome.
On our show. Yep. So
just type it into that email and put subject audience so that we know you're wanting to be in the audience.
Outstanding.
Thanks to the sponsors.
Yes.
Harlan Hogan.
Voiceover Extra.
Edge Studio.
Source Elements.
VO2GoGo.
And Antland Productions for providing the uninterrupted stream that you are watching, which apparently didn't work so well on Facebook tonight. But
yeah, it was an I guess it is still kind of new. It's kind of beta, and we were streaming on it for a really long time, like 40 minutes before the show even started tonight.
Right.
So maybe that's part of the problem. Maybe. We'll try it again next week. I mean, the good thing is it didn't take down the other stream. So when the Facebook thing pooped out and I got this error messages on my screen and my heart skipped a beat, it didn't screw up the main feed.
Well, that's good to know, because everybody was watching both.
Yes.
Going, which one are we watching? This one's
apparently
faster
than
this one.
The Facebook one has less latency, less delay. Like it was much, and it looked really good.
Cool.
Apparently.
Alrighty. Got to thank Marcy for painting today.
Yeah.
Getting me to paint. The kitchen's almost done, by the way. It's going to be beautiful. Get a magnificent kitchen.
And that bathroom is post on par, I'm excited about.
That's true. Our producer, Catherine Curridan, for getting us fine guests like Johnny Heller and this fine lineup we've got coming up over the next couple of weeks. Shelly Avellino was in the chat room tonight and throwing our questions to us. Jack DeGoli for the show notes, and Lee Penny for just being Lee Penny, but also helping with the podcast.
That's right.
All right. After the show, we have there's a new video.
Oh, there is?
There is.
Well.
It's in the Dropbox.
I better go find it.
You better go find it, because Jacob is, sometimes he says, I'm in a creative slump. We should all be in this kid's creative slump, because he does more in a day in a creative slump than we do in a lifetime some days.
That's pretty impressive.
Yes. It's called Elby and Azul.
Elby and Azul.
Elby and Azul.
Really?
Maybe. Let's see where he put it here.
I'm in the VOBS. I'm in Guest Essentials, Stories, Package, Episodes, Sponsors, Mugman. It's not in the Mugman folder, is it?
It might be.
Did he actually put it right into the Dropbox?
Yeah, I think he
did.
Or
did he just send us a link?
I think he might have put it right into our Dropbox.
Well, then. Into the root directory? No.
No.
Was there an email in the
Yeah, there was. There was, yes.
All right, well, maybe I'll go find it.
All right, we'll go find it. Anyway.
Why don't you vamp?
I will vamp. We got a great show next week. We've got, we appreciate everybody coming here. Again, if you got a tech question, it helps a lot if you send it to us so we can plan on answering it here on VoiceOver Body Shop, theguys@vobs.tv. That's the place to send it. So that's the easiest way to do it.
What was that thing called? The Mugman? Was it Mugman or Plancy?
No, this one is called. It's called.
A whole new series?
A whole new series. Well, it's something new he's trying.
Spinoff? Okay,
it's just not even a spinoff. It's a different type of style that he's trying. It's called Elby and
ALD.
Azul.
Oh, there we go.
Oh, it's right there.
There's a link to it right there. I can download it or even stream it right from here.
We can stream it right from there.
But it might take me a little while. See, I didn't read my entire checklist. So if this was an airplane, we would be landing without landing gear right now, or which would be really bad.
No flaps, coming in hot and fast. Anyway, stay tuned for that. That's going to do it for us tonight. I'm Dan Leonard.
And I'm George Whittam, multitasking.
He's doing a great job of it. And this is VoiceOver
Body Shop.
Or VO.
Did the video freeze?
No.
Oh, no, that was me.
Yeah.
BS.
All right. We'll see you next week, everybody. Watch Elby and Azul here. We'll see you next time.
See you guys. Bye.
Thank you. You're listening to VOBS. You're listening to V.
Fighting broke out overnight for Sundays. And
what do you want to watch tonight?
I don't know. I mean, the same stuff's always on all the time.
Oh, I am so sick of American Pickers. What about VOBS?
Yes! Oh my gosh, you just read my mind! That's
it.
Perfect!
I want to watch it because you know why? They got the best BS about VO.
VOBS. Mondays, 9 Eastern, 6 Pacific on VOBS.us.
Learn the latest in voiceover technology, business, and good old-fashioned acting.
I really like your bracelet. It's awesome.
Hey, Paul, where did you get that watch?
That's really cool.
And a hamburger with no cheese, please.
Every Monday, 9 Eastern, 6 Pacific, only on voiceoverbodyshop.com.
You're watching VOBS.TV. I don't know why. It's crazy what they do here. I think I'm going to go somewhere else and have a cheese sandwich.
Every Monday, 9 Eastern, 6 Pacific.
VoiceOver Body Shop. I love when they talk BS about VO. Before time began, there was VOBS.TV. Watch or else.
Having dinner tonight? How about having some VO too?
VoiceOver Body Shop.
Have some voiceover with your dinner tonight on VoiceOver Body Shop, 9 Eastern, 6 Pacific.
This is John Bailey, the Epic Voice, and you're watching VOBS.TV, Monday nights at 6 p.m. Pacific, 9:30 Newfoundland.
VoiceOver Body Shop. Learn the latest in voiceover technology. Learn how to get rid of that. VoiceOver Body Shop, 9 Eastern, 6 Pacific, on VOBS.us.